Hello everyone, and welcome to the Nuclear Criticality Safety Lecture Series. My name is Chris Perfetti, and I'm an assistant professor in the Nuclear Engineering Department at the University of New Mexico. The lectures in this series will cover the course material for an undergraduate or graduate course in nuclear criticality safety, including a review of neutron and reactor physics, a survey of historical criticality safety accidents, their causes, and lessons learned, a review of the computational methods used for developing upper subcritical limits, and best practices for maintaining criticality safety and developing a healthy safety culture. This course will assume that you have some background in reactor physics and radiation transport. An undergraduate course in these areas should suffice, but if you don't have this background, then I recommend watching my nuclear reactor physics lecture series before diving into these criticality safety lectures. I'll provide a link to these reactor physics lectures in this video's description. So what is the goal of nuclear criticality safety? Simply put, our goal is to ensure that we don't make a nuclear reactor anywhere where we don't want to have one. A perhaps more articulate definition is to first, avoid any criticality accidents, and second, to protect personnel from the consequences of any criticality accidents or events. This is an important distinction that adds an element of depth to nuclear criticality safety. We don't just want to avoid having a criticality accident, but we also want to understand how to design operations and facilities to mitigate the impact of any accidents. So what are the elements of nuclear criticality safety? Well, like most other nuclear engineering fields, nuclear criticality safety relies on having an understanding of neutron and reactor physics, which usually involves codes, computational models, and access to accurate nuclear data. However, unlike some other fields and some other nuclear engineering courses, such as reactor physics, radiation shielding, or thermal hydraulics at an academic level, learning criticality safety requires an understanding of both engineering concerns and administrative practices, where these engineering concerns include the design and implementation of different components, structures, and physical controls in a system, and where the administrative practices involve the development and implementation of rules, procedures, practices, and administrative controls. We'll discuss these concepts much more later on in this course, but the takeaway for now is that nuclear criticality safety requires a lot more thought than just simply running MCMP. However, like the areas of reactor physics and radiation shielding, a successful nuclear criticality safety analyst will develop an engineering intuition for how different systems behave. Unlike other safety disciplines, this intuition is sometimes counterintuitive, and safety decisions may change based on what kind of system is involved. For example, consider an array of fuel pins that is submerged in some sort of coolant. So how will removing one fuel pin from the system affect the system's eigenvalue? Well, it depends. If this is a low-enriched uranium light water reactor system, which are typically under-moderated, then replacing a fuel pin with more water coolant will increase the system's eigenvalue. On the other hand, if this is a fast reactor system, then removing any fuel at all and replacing it with coolant or structure or anything else will serve to soften the spectrum and will cause K-effective to decrease. So as you can see, the impact of some change or some error on a system's eigenvalue depends on physical characteristics. And by extension, the viable actions we can take to avoid a criticality accident will actually vary from system to system. Let's consider one other example of how proper safety actions might be system-dependent. Let's consider a system that involves some volume of a uranium-235 solution, perhaps uranyl nitrate. If we plot the necessary critical mass for the system against the concentration of U-235 in the solution, then we see that there is some level of optimal moderation that produces the smallest critical mass possible. If we increase the uranium-235 concentration beyond this optimal point, then the system is under-moderated. If we decrease the uranium-235 concentration below this point, then our system is over-moderated. So what happens, and what should we do, if we have a system that is, by accident, mixed so that it was too close to being critical to be safe to handle? An operator who has had insufficient criticality safety training might seek to diffuse a situation and make our solution safe to handle by diluting it with nitric acid. After all, reducing the uranium concentration should make it more difficult to achieve criticality, right? Wrong. If the system is over here and it's under-moderated, then adding more moderation will move it towards optimal moderation and could result in a criticality accident. These thought exercises show how the safety principles in criticality safety might often depend significantly on the type of system that we're dealing with, and that they might often be intuitive or at odds with safety principles from other fields. Thinking of other fields, let's say that we have a new analyst who transfers in who previously worked in radiation shielding before moving into criticality safety. In radiation shielding, our modus operandi is to confine a radiation source so that it's contained in a limited area, and then to add shielding around it to protect people from the radiation that it emits. However, in criticality safety, these well-intentioned actions can have the opposite effect and make the system less safe. Collecting and concentrating the system will decrease its neutron leakage, which will thus increase its eigenvalue, and adding shielding around the system will simply provide reflection for neutrons that are leaking, which will also increase its eigenvalue. So in short, nuclear criticality safety is complicated. The best course of action for making sure that a system is safe will often vary significantly based on that system's physical properties, and may also be counterintuitive compared to best safety practices from other fields. This is why criticality safety can be a difficult field to learn for people who don't have a criticality safety background, and why proper criticality safety training is so important. Now, throughout this course, we will review multiple criticality safety accidents. We'll do this both to learn what went wrong in these circumstances, and also to gain an understanding of how we might prevent these accidents in the future. What we'll see is that most criticality accidents happen because the site hazard analysis misses ways that things could go wrong. In other words, it's the unknown unknowns that get you and cause criticality accidents. An accident is by definition an unplanned event, and thus they are usually caused by dangers that we didn't even realize existed. For example, we understand that there are errors in nuclear data and possibly in our modeling and simulation codes, but this kind of threat is a known unknown. Because we know that this danger exists, we can add a margin of subcriticality to any calculations when we design systems using these codes. As a result, and thanks to the efforts of some very talented and hardworking code developers, no criticality accidents have ever occurred due to errors in our modeling and simulation codes. This certainly speaks highly to the QA and verification efforts made by the people who develop and test these codes, but it also shows how most criticality accidents are caused by factors that seem at first too outlandish to even consider. Who could have guessed that an operator would have put 4 times the allowed limit of uranium slugs into this container without even realizing it? Or who would have guessed that this pipe would have leaked a high concentration uranium solution that has accumulated in the pipe over time? Had these systems performed as designed and as anticipated, then they never would have caused a criticality accident. But they did cause criticality accidents because of unknown risks and unknown system failures that we didn't even think to consider. So with this in mind, how can we make a facility safe? Well, it's pretty easy. First, we make sure that the facility doesn't contain any uranium, and then we make sure that the facility doesn't contain any people. However, if we actually want to get things done in these facilities, then facilities will have to balance risk versus reward when they design a criticality safety program. Implementing additional safety measures will generally limit throughput of material or slow down operations or require expensive and time-consuming safety training programs. The trick to balancing risk versus reward here is to design a facility that runs as efficiently as possible yet is still safe. A laissez-faire attitude and a no-rules facility with absolutely no safety precautions might run more efficiently for a while, but it will eventually be forced to shut down, perhaps temporarily, perhaps permanently, when a criticality accident inevitably occurs. This illustrates one of the most important principles in nuclear criticality safety, that you pay for safety whether you like it or not. A facility with a sloppy safety culture or loosely enforced safety rules will inevitably have a criticality accident. They'll either be forced to shut down and redesign their criticality safety program from the design up, or they'll continue to pay for their sloppy safety with lives. Either way, the site will pay for criticality safety, and there's no question that it's better to pay for safety up front before lives are lost. And even after we design a criticality safety program facility, we shouldn't forget about Donald Rumsfeld and his unknown unknowns. Spending a lot of money designing a facility that is impervious to criticality concerns is not enough. Criticality accidents are not caused by the things that we designed against and anticipated, but by the things that we didn't anticipate. Just like the unsinkable ship, thinking that you have a safe facility is a trap. Letting safety slip to the back of your mind and sliding into a sloppy safety culture is how accidents happen. This concludes the first of our nuclear criticality safety lectures. In the next lecture, we'll review the health effects that are caused by radiation during a criticality accident, and we will also review the first two fatal criticality accidents, both of which were caused by the Demon Core in Los Alamos.